Bismillah, walhamdulillah, my dear sisters and my brothers, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullah. Yesterday I received the visit of an old friend of mine, a Sheikh from the University of Al-Azhar in Cairo. He specializes in the Qur'an studies, so he has learned all the 10 recitations, as he says it. And each of these 10 ways of reciting the Qur'an, all traceable to the Messenger of Allah. It is common practice with these sheikhs that they say to you that he learned the Qur'an from, and then he will tell you the chain of narrators from whom he learned. So basically he's going to say, I learned from Sheikh X, who learned it from another one, who learned it, blah, 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 until they get to the Messenger of Allah, that is the last. And then they will add two very dangerous words, and they say, from Jibreel, from Allah. So basically what the Sheikh is saying is that the Qur'an he is reciting comes straight away from Allah, because their chain of narrators ends with Allah. Okay, now that is one thing. As we are today in the 2019, the best chain of narrators, because what they say is this: the shorter the chain of narrator is, the more potent and the more reliable and the better the reciter is. So right now, the chain of narrators can go to 28 sheikhs, some of them 29, some of them to 30. So basically say, I personally, if I had learned the Qur'an from this sheikh particular, he would be, because he has 28 reciters till he gets to the Messenger, and then Jibreel, then Allah. So if I learned from him, he'll be my 29th sheikh, and so on and so forth. So this sheikh is an expert in Qur'an recitations. He knows every rule about it and all the sciences around it. So when he came, the point of him coming here is because he intended of coming to my son's funerals, but due to some family issues, he couldn't make it. So he wanted to visit me, especially that we were good friends and for years we haven't met. So he wanted to come and sit with me and chit chat and things like that. What started the whole thing altogether is when he told me, let's meet on Friday after Jum'ah, after the prayers. And then he asked me, where do you pray? I told him, I do not pray the Jum'ah prayers. And he said, why do you do that? So this is all on the phone conversation. And I said to him, because I do not believe that Jum'ah is actually prescribed on us as a weekly duty. He goes, the Hadeeth. I said to him, look, Sheikh, I said before, my friend, I call him by his name, but I don't want to name him. So I said to him, so when I say Sheikh, I would have said his name. I said to him, look, if Al-Jum'ah was of any value to us, then Allah would have spoken about it in Al-Quran. He goes, but he did. I said, where? He goes, as Allah says in Al-Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا إِذَا نُودِيَ لِلصَّلَاةِ مِنْ يَوْمِ الْجُمْعَةِ. You who believe, when the Salat is called upon from the day of the gathering. This is literally what the translation is. He goes, there you go, Jum'ah. And of course, bear in mind this reality. I understand that he is a very specialized Sheikh in the Quran and things like that. So whenever I speak to him, I try not to say anything that will make him feel bad or kind of like make myself feel superior. So kind of like I keep in mind that I need to talk to him, speak the truth and speak everything, but do it in a subtle way where he doesn't feel attacked. So I told him, ya Sheikh, I said to him, Allah did not say on Yawmul Jum'ah, on the day of Jum'ah. He goes, on the day from the days of your gathering. So what Allah is telling us is, whenever you are on a meeting for marketing or doing a business market day, and the Salat is called, so go to that Salat. When I said this, he realized that he didn't pay attention to something, that Allah was not talking about Friday per se, but more about the day of a meeting. And then we came to, then he said to me on the phone, he's still on the phone, he goes, Abu Hanifa, that's how he refers to me. I said, yeah, he goes, so are you one of those people who reject the Hadith? I said to him, ya Sheikh, this is not a topic to be spoken on the phone lightly like that. I said, why don't you come and visit me and then we'll have a good conversation. I said, okay. Anyway, give and take few, yes, meet here. No, I can't do it, do that. But anyhow, so yesterday he came and we sat together. Condolences bad and a little bit about my child. But I didn't want to speak about my child because the pain is too big and I didn't want to just start crying all around again. So we jumped straight away to the topic. Pay attention. This sheikh is an expert in Al-Quran. He knows how you would pronounce one letter from the Quran and will you stop, all that kind of stuff. So the conversation started with his question, what is your position vis-a-vis Hadith? How do you deal with the Hadith? I said to him, before I tell you how I regard a Hadith, why not have a conversation and I'll tell you why the Hadith to me is not of a big value at all. Now this Sheikh knows me and he knows my knowledge, I don't know, it comes like I'm a big shot, but it's not. But he just knows who I am. So I'm not his general day-to-day person, and he also knows my qualification and studies and things like that. So the talk is equal, him to me. It's so the conversation started when I started telling him that it is impossible for the messenger of Allah, being a messenger, being an envoy of Allah, to legislate, especially that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has said in Al-Quran, وَلَا يُشْرِكُ فِي حُكْمِي أَحَدًا. Allah does not share his rulings, what he issues as halal or haram, with anybody. And I mentioned a few other ayat from the Quran. Now you would think, like just by reading the Quran to this sheikh, everything should go, oh my God, yes, you're right. No. And he started now arguing the case that Allah had revealed one revelation, but that revelation is made of two parts, the Quran and the Sunnah. I didn't want to argue this one, so I told him, okay, let's take what you call the Sunnah. I said, you're telling me now that Allah has mentioned the Hadith and everything? He goes, yes. I said, when Allah revealed in the last year of the life of the Messenger, about 3 months before he died, that today I have, اليوم أكملت لكم دينكم, today I have completed your religion for you. وَأَتْمَمْتُ عَلَيْكُمْ نِعْمَتِي, and I have perfected my favor upon you. Still Allah is talking about the religion of Islam. وَرَضِيتُ لَكُمُ الْإِسْلَامَ دِينًا, and I am very satisfied for the Islam that is in the Quran for you as a religion. So I told him, ya Sheikh, this ayah was revealed 90 days before the death of the messenger, and every scholar agrees unanimously that after this ayah there was no halal and no haram. End of it. Allah with that ayah has closed everything about al-Islam. And then for the next 3 months, Allah reveals to the messenger that إِذَا جَاءَ نَصْرُ اللَّهِ وَالْفَتْحُ, when the support of Allah and the help of Allah comes to you, and the land opens to you, and the tribe starts entering al-Islam in groups, then you, Muhammad, what should you do? You should continue praying, and you ask Allah for forgiveness, and because in preparation for death. So I told him, do you agree to that? He goes, yes, of course I do. I said, how comes Allah says to us that he perfected the religion, ends it, and closed everything, and the Hadith was left loose for another 2.5 centuries until the 3rd century, and just like that, and then 300 years later, we have the Hadith, knowing that all the companions always agreed that they always went to the Quran. It's in Al-Bukhari, in the historian books, in the books of Hadith. I told him also, didn't our mother Aisha speak about the messenger and say that he was a walking Quran? When I told him, when our mother Aisha said about the messenger that he was, and I kept quiet and he carried on the sentence. He said he was a walking Quran. I said, at the time of the messenger, when he was alive, if the companions heard something, a ruling from Allah, I said, would they go to the messenger and say, what did Allah reveal to you on the other side of the Hadith? Is it compatible with what's in the Quran? Or was it only they asked about what Allah revealed? He goes, well, as it is, it's what Allah revealed. I said then further, it's incredible how much he agrees and how much he disagrees at the same time. I told him, in Al-Quran, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala talks about, we should always use the Quran as a means of reminding people, and that nothing else. Quraysh didn't ask Muhammad, the Messenger of Allah, that is the Qur'an, what is the Hadith? I even told him the ayah of Al-Qur'an. When Quraysh told the Messenger, baddil Al-Qur'an, change the Qur'an, or play with the context with it. And I said that Allah told them in the Qur'an that it is not befit of the Messenger. And he said it in Al-Qur'an. So basically what I was trying to do with the Sheikh is remind him that the entire Quran talks that only the authority of Al Quran is what makes Al Islam, not the acts of the Messenger, not his wordings. Then he turns to me and he goes, "What about Wama Yantaqu Anil Hawa?" This is a very, very, very famous ayah that anyone you talk to, they straightway will tell you the Messenger does not speak out of his own desires. I told him, "Ya Sheikh, the ayah doesn't say what you're saying. The ayah doesn't say, and he does not speak out of his desires. The ayah says, وَمَا يَنْطِقُ عَنِ الْهَوَىٰ. A nutq in Arabic is when you say, when something, a sound comes out of you, and it is understandable. You understand it. I said, that is a nutq. What people understand is your wordings. That's the speech. If someone, for example, if someone cannot do the nutq, is person who cannot talk. They will go, these people, they cannot nutq, they cannot utter at all. I told him, animals, if you take a cat, the cat talks because it can talk to other cats. Fish have a communication, ants, bees, and everything. But do they speak? Do they utter words? They do not. I said what Allah is telling Quraysh, because Quraysh had accused the Messenger of being crazy, of being this, of being a magician, of being a sorcerer, of being a fortune teller, of being somebody. Basically, they accused him of anything. Allah tells Quraysh, and this is what I told him, all I'm telling you is what I told him. So Allah tells Quraysh that when Muhammad, when the Messenger speaks the Quran, he does not have a choice. He speaks it like when you press play on your phone or your tape player. He only reiterates and produces the sounds that makes the Quran intelligible to you. And then I told him, "Ya Sheikh, the Quran, when it comes from Allah, it does not come in Arabic. It's taken from the mother book, and then Allah gives it in the language that is from the mother book to Jibreel. Jibreel transmits to Muhammad, to the Messenger of Allah, and then what happens is when the Messenger speaks Arabic, and that's where at-tibyan litubayyana lin-nasi ma nuzila ilayhim, so that you clarify to people what has been revealed unto them. Because if the Quran was spoken to us by Jibreel, we would not understand it, because it's in the mother of a book. We cannot understand that. Let me give you an example. My sound right now that you are listening to right now, when I record it to my computer, I have an iMac. So I use a microphone. The moment the vibration of my voice hit the membrane or the part of the microphone, that changes the vibration of my voice into electricity. That electricity is taken into my Logic Pro, the software that I use to record my sounds and produce it. And then I turn that into a talk, and then I send it to WhatsApp. All this is digital. It's zeros and ones. It's got no voice whatsoever. So when you download it on your WhatsApp and you start listening, what your phone does is this. It takes the information of the zero and ones that make the sound file, and then the reader on your phone translates the zeros and one into sounds, and that's how you hear my voices. Does your phone talk? It does not, but your phone translates what I have said, and actually what's on your phone from the zeros and ones, and that's why you understand what I'm saying. If the phone did not translate the zeros and ones, what you will hear is this: 01100011100000100000. That's how my sound is. So the original sound on your phone are zeros and ones. That's what it the digital is. So when Allah, and I explained this to the Sheikh, when Allah gives the Quran to Jibreel, he gives it to him just for arguments, just for to explain this, in 0 1. And if the Messenger was to speak to Quraysh the 0 and 1s, Quraysh would understand nothing. So Jibreel would bring it to the Messenger, and the Messenger acts as your phone. as your computer, as anything that is going to change the zeros and ones into something that you and I can understand. And when he does that, the messenger does not have a choice in what he says. Even if, for example, that's why Allah says to the messenger that he will protect him. And the protection, why is the protection guaranteed to the messenger? Because Allah knows that once the messenger starts playing what Allah has recorded in him through Jibreel, he will say things that Quraysh do not like and they might kill the messenger. So Allah tells the Prophet Muhammad, I give you a guarantee, once you start speaking, you don't speak out of yourself. You have no control how the sounds will come out. Just like you have no control on my voice when it is played on your phone. All you gotta do is listen to it. That's what it is, I told him. So, and then he starts, and I said, so it's not uttering and speaking, are not the two things. And then he jumped to another ayah, where ati'u Allah wa ati'u Rasul, obey Allah and obey the messenger. So basically he says, whatever the messenger does or says or anything becomes an Islam. I told him, but that is not what Allah says. And I gave him the example. The police, why do we obey the police when they stop us on the road? Well, because the Ministry of Interior or the Home Office are the ones that told the public that if the police stops you, then you stop. That's why we stop to them. So basically, when we obey the police people, we're not obeying them because they are the police, but because the Home Office of whatever country ordered us. And again, I explained to him, imagine you have 4 or 5 kids, and you send one of the children to tell the other ones to come to your room. So you send your child as a messenger, and you send him with what? With an order from you to your child. The kid goes to his brother, to his sister, or anything, and he tells them, come to the room. My dad wants you. Are the children going to tell him, no, we need some kind of document, certificate? You need? No, they're going to come. Why? Because they understand that that kid is speaking on behalf of the father. He is the messenger that relays the message of the father to the children, and that's why they come. Again, he looks at me, and then he starts talking about the Qur'an evasively. And then I told him, Sheikh, please, for the sake of Allah, I said, Allah, you know very well the Qur'an that you teach to people is the only source of commands. And then he asked me, so will you eat a donkey? The donkeys that live with us. I said, yeah. He goes, well, the hadith prohibits it and makes it haram. I told him, subhanallah, Allah in Al-Quran has found a space and time to tell us that every day we have 3 times of privacy and that our children should not enter our bedrooms unless they knock on the door. So I told him, Allah finds a way to tell us we eat together as a group or individually, and he will miss the opportunity to tell me that an animal cannot be eaten. I said, ya Sheikh, fear Allah. And then the Sheikh started finding himself just because of the amount of the Quran, and he's an expert, and every time I mention an ayah from the Quran, I always precede it with, you know better than me that ayah says this or that or explains this and things like that. And then he told me, why should I listen to your explanation of the Quran and not others? I told him, no, you don't have to listen to me. I said, what I'm telling you is already in the books, but these books, what is in those books is not made public. It's just a school of thoughts. And then I went to the issue of speaking about the hadith and how it was collected and brought some differences. I said to him, we marry, we divorce, we do everything according to the hadith. He goes, no. I said, yes. And then I mentioned an example in Al-Quran that Christians do and we don't do. And it is in Al-Quran where Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala tells us to make our vows at the time of marriage. And I ask any Muslim or believer that got married, have you ever had vows exchanged with your husband and wife? No. But the Quran says that there are vows. But I told him, and we divorce according to the hadith. We do everything according to the hadith. And then I told him about the school of thoughts, the differences, and how people are confused. You divorce on one school of thoughts, and people start shopping around. Maybe there is an argument. Maybe there is a fatwa. Maybe there is a point of view that doesn't agree with this. And people now live in between these fatwas. Something is haram here. Another sheikh will come, no, it's not haram. A third one, he says, it's only disliked, and so on and so forth. I said to him, Islam has become a joke. And then he started our righteous predecessors. I said, don't get me started. There is no such a thing as righteous predecessors. He goes to Sahaba. I said, the Qur'an has hardly ever spoken good about the companions. And when it speaks good about those companions, it speaks about a tiny minority. Most of them are hypocrites. Most of them did this and did that. And I said to him, look at the Qur'an. And I mentioned a few ayat in here and there. And then he said, no, these people are reliable. I said, they were not reliable. That's why in one hadith, you hear one thing, and then it's another version. In another version is this, and in another version is that. I told him, you have one incident, one person that, for example, the hadith of Jibril coming, and what the messenger asks the messenger, what is belief, what is Islam, what is this, and what is that. It's one incident that came, and a few companions were seated, but the different types of the hadith mentioned by those companions is extremely incredible, the differences between them. So what they did was they just took one part of that hadith and they narrated it, but they ignored the other ones. The sheikhs know that one hadith, one incident, and it can have 10 different versions. I said, you have become worse than Christians. I said to him, with Christians, we blame them that everything evolves around Jesus. And we, as the believers, we have taken the Quran from being the heart of Islam, and now it's the messenger. Everything as it is Sunnah, the messenger of Allah did this, and the messenger of Allah did that, and things like that. Again, he jumped to the thing, and he goes, so you don't believe in the hadith? At which point I told him, no, it's not about me not believing the hadith. I said, any hadith that says something is halal or haram to me is time zero. It means absolutely not a thing. I told him, Sheikh, you read in the Quran that on judgment day, to which book will Allah hold us responsible? He said, the Quran. I said, will there be Bukhari, Muslim, and the things of the scholar? He goes, no. I said, then anything that is not valid on judgment day shouldn't be valid now, right? He goes, no, the Sunnah. I said, the Sheikh, on judgment day, what is the messenger of Allah, Muhammad, will do? Isn't he going to hold the Quran and tell Allah, my Lord, Ya Rabbi, inna qawmi ittakhadhu hadha al-Quran majura, my people have undertaken, have made this Quran, considered it abandoned? And because it's Quran, he cannot deny that. He goes, yeah. I said, why did the messenger on judgment day, why is not in the Quran that he will say hadith and my sunnah and everything? Why does he mention only the Quran, ya Sheikh? I said, fear Allah. And then he looks at me, but he says, but the wahi, the revelation, is two parts, the Quran and the sunnah. I said, ya Sheikh, do you understand? All this, of course, is impoliteness, but I get really upset and totally out of it when I think about how these people think. I told them on judgment day, the Prophet Muhammad, the messenger of Allah, will hold the Quran in one hand and will point to the believers who have abandoned the Quran, and the complaint that the messenger of Allah will make, the single one, is my people have undertaken, have abandoned the Quran deliberately. I said, I'm telling you now this, and you're telling me that? And then I mentioned a few other ayat and a few other hadith. I even showed him ayat from the Quran where Allah says that it is Allah who has descended this Quran with the absolute truth, and it is Allah who has explained the Quran, and he has detailed it, and all that is wanted from us is just to study the Quran, to ponder upon the Quran. Allah did not bring the hadith. Allah did not bring the sunnah. Allah brought nothing of the messenger because Allah knew that the messenger would die. And then we are stuck. So the messenger of Allah to us today is the Qur'an. I told him the message of Allah to you today. What is it, ya Sheikh? He goes, the Qur'an. I said, where'd you get all this sunnah and all these things? And then he said, well, our scholars are reliable. I said, no, they're not reliable. They were under the effects of politics and they were under the school of thoughts and the arguments, and Allah has blown their cover in Al-Quran. And he has told us that 99% away from politics and things like that, but 99% of the problems between sheikhs and scholars is envy. They don't like it, and that's why the scholars are very envious of each other. So much so that there is this law, this rule in our sphere that the scholars say. They say two people that are contemporary, that they live together, if they attack each other, we ignore both insults and arguments. Why? Because they are envious of each other. I said, that shouldn't be the case. I told him Imam Malik, who is the closest to whatever you say called Sunnah, right? I said, his book, Al-Muwatta, should have been the first book we go back to, but it's ignored. I told him we don't have the original copy of Al-Bukhari, that the Bukhari of today. I asked him first, did you read Fath al-Sari, i.e. the introduction that Ibn Hajar, the man who explained Al-Bukhari, wrote? It's about 13 or 15 volumes, depending on which edition. And I told him, did you read it? He goes, yes, I read it. And I know he didn't write it, because if he did, he would have known what I was going to tell him. But hey, you know, we are humans. So I told him, ya Sheikh, in that introduction, didn't Ibn Hajar al-Asqalani say that when he wanted to explain Sharh al-Bukhari and comment on its hadith, that he said that he found about 13 versions of al-Bukhari with different hadiths and different, sometimes different chain of narrators, and that he was the greatest mechanic that actually conjured up the present Bukhari that we have today? He took 13 different people that have different versions altogether, and he messed that whole up, and he came with Sahih al-Bukhari. And he looked at me, and I knew in his eyes that he didn't know this. I said, how can I trust in Sahih al-Bukhari when I don't have the original copy that he wrote? How can I follow something called Hadith or Sunnah in Muslim and I don't have the original Hadith? Why did other scholars, Abu Dawood, Tirmidhi ibn Majah, Daraqutni, Tabarani, why all these scholars of Hadith also wrote Hadiths, if al-Bukhari was the top rock and roll, top best person? Why? And then he kept coming back always to the revelation from Allah is the Quran and Sunnah. And at that point there, I told him, ya Sheikh, if you carry on saying like this, then you have associated with Allah the Hadith and Sunnah. You have also, he goes, what? I said, Allah says that he descended only the Quran. Whatever is in the Quran is the law. And you're telling me that no, the Hadith, he says, he goes, let me ask you a question. I go ahead. Yes. He goes, can you marry a woman and her aunt? And I go, why do you ask? He goes, because the Hadith prohibits, makes it haram that a man should marry a woman and her auntie. And I go, is that mentioned in Al-Quran? He goes, no. I said, then it is halal. He goes, but the Hadith, I said, so Allah in your eyes, ya Sheikh, has forgotten to tell us about this? Or hasn't he? He goes, but the Hadith, I said, ya Sheikh, that's where the problem is between me and you. Me? I don't care much for the Hadith when it is not in the Quran. You have prioritized the Hadith over the Quran. And then the argument, the conversation, well, and you kept jumping here and there. But here is what I get out of this. The meeting went for about 3 hours, but I just don't want to take it for the whole hour. But here is what I found out with a friend of mine, a very intelligent person. But what I found out is this person has been programmed to think in certain manner. He doesn't see any problem that the book of Allah is not the priority. He is not the number one legislation in our lives. To him, Allah has revealed the Quran and the Sunnah. I even went to the extreme of telling him, if you believe that the Hadith and Sunnah are revelation from Allah, you have accused Allah of being a liar. Because Allah says in the Quran that he only revealed the Quran. Qur'an. And even Allah calls his Qur'an a hadith. I said, but you telling me, no. Allah has not revealed only the Qur'an. He revealed something else called the Sunnah. I said, how on Judgment Day are you going to reconcile between these two? Allah says, I sent down the Qur'an only. And you say, no, he sent the hadith also. And as towards the end like this, and he had to pick up his child, so on his way out, I told him, yeah, Sheikh, I said, always remember one thing. What's not valid on Judgment Day is not valid today. I said, on Judgment Day, the only book that's going to matter, if someone doesn't come in good terms with Allah on Judgment Day, and we'll start arguing, يَوْمَ تَأْتِي كُلُّ نَفْسٍ تُجَادِلُ عَنْ نَفْسِهَا. I told him, you know that on Judgment Day, each human will come defending himself or herself. And then when they will start talking nonsense, and with their talk they're getting nowhere, that is when the time, that's the time where Allah will order the mouth to shut up, and then the hands and legs and limbs starts talking. Okay, when somebody, and I mentioned to him, somebody who in his life was not following the commands of Allah, was too much in sin and everything, so he did not have a good relationship with Allah. On Judgment Day, he will raise and he will say, قَالَ رَبِّي لِمَا حَشَرْتَنِي أَعْمَى. Ya Allah, why did you resurrect me blind? I cannot see, I am totally blind. وَقَدْ كُنْتُ بَصِيرًا. And when I was in life, I was somebody observant. I could see with my eyes. I.e., what has changed, Ya Allah? Then Allah will tell him, كَذَلِكَ أَتَتْكَ آيَاتُنَا. You are in this situation blind today. That's because at one point when you lived in this life and you had your eyes perfectly working well, our ayat, the text in Al-Quran or the Torah or the Gospel or from any book that Allah has mentioned, and again, the Quran included, but what did you do? فَنَسِيتَهَا. You delayed it. You did not prioritize it. You just left it second, third, fourth seat. Then Allah tells him, وَكَذَلِكَ الْيَوْمَ تُنْسَى. And your treatment, the way you treated my Quran, my Torah, my Gospel, whatever I revealed, my book in this life, then you shall get the same treatment. I said, Allah does on Judgment Day, no sunnah, not a thing. I said, the idea that the Prophet Muhammad will be a big shot on Judgment Day is a false dream, Ya Sheikh. I said, and you know that from the Quran. And as he was coming out and I opened the door and I finished this, he told me, but the wahi, the revelation of Allah, is the Quran and Sunnah. I told him, you're leaving now, so give me a hug, and we smiled like this. I said, the next time we meet up, we will talk more about this. And then on his way out, he said something strange. He goes, Ya Abdussalam, I will make dua, and I will make dua for Allah to guide you. I said, guide me from prioritizing the Quran to sharing the ruling of Allah with hadith and sayings of scholars. I said, is that what you're wanting from me? Are you making dua for me that on Judgment Day that I be amongst the Quran and neglectors? I said, is that what you want from me? Is that what you're going to make dua for? I said, no, thank you. I said, I will make dua for you that you will awake one day before it's too late and you die. Somebody who has made a life, a living out from teaching the Quran, but you don't know. You don't know most of it. Of course, I said it nicely. And I forgot to say, throughout the Quran, when I come to an ayah, I will tell him, Ya Sheikh, what do you think this ayah means? At one point he said something, and then I gave him, no, that is not what it means. It means that. Two or three points. This has already happened before, when I would say something and then he wouldn't get the meaning right. He's just somebody who knows how to recite the Quran, but the meanings is escape him. So I would tell him, no, this is this and this is that. And at which point he started feeling embarrassed. And then he tells me, are you going to teach me? I said, no, I'm not going to teach you. I'm just pointing to a point that the Quran is not respected as it ought to be. And then we hugged each other, and until next time, I said, you be in the mercy of Allah. And we talked like this. And then the thing that I will come to at this point here, again, it's past a half an hour, is that even those who claim to be lovers of the Qur'an, just like as this Sheikh, you know, the 10 recitation and all that kind of stuff. And I told him in the conversation, I said to him, why do you know the 10 recitation? If there is only one Qur'an that came from Allah, and then why do we have the 10 types? He goes, well, because the Arabs used to recite the Qur'an differently. I said to him, wouldn't it have been more just of Allah to reveal the Qur'an in Arabic, in Latin, in Romans, in Greek, so in English, French, so that the other nations have an opportunity to read the Qur'an right as Allah sent it? Wouldn't that have been more just and more doable from a God rather than sending it to the language of this tribe or the way that tribe speaks? I said, Sheikh, what's up with you? I said to him, the Quran you say was gathered by Uthman. Allah in Al-Quran says it is Allah that gathered the Quran, that collected it. And the Prophet Muhammad, before dying, the book was completed with him. I said, where does Uthman come in? And do you know what I've now realized? Is that people become robots. People do not use the minds. People read something in the Quran, but to them it's, I read it, it's no big deal. It's just like when you drive on the highway and you see speed limits 50, but you are doing 70. You read it's 50, but you don't act upon it. You just see it, it's there. It's just like a billboard. And this is really disturbing. This Sheikh, instead of just going to the Quran, and especially with the ayah, the plethora, the great number of ayah that I recited to him, he should have said, you know what, you're right. He kept arguing to the last minute that the hadith is a revelation from Allah. This is the problem we are facing. He said, he promised that he's going to get back to me one day. And I said, yeah, please do so. And I pray to Allah that he comes back and I'll keep talking to him. We're good friends, even though the conversation heated up, because it was very disturbing to me. Because the equation that Allah always wanted and still wants from us is that one, Allah, must always be plus zero. Equals one. That's what the equation, that what Allah wants. But he tells me that one plus one, i.e. Allah's Quran, plus the messenger and his sunnah, still equals one. I tell him, no, it equals two. That is the disturbing thing, and that's the fight that we have to do. And of course, we have to have compassion in our hearts, because if Allah has opened our hearts to the Quran, and we are doing our very best to act on the teachings of the Quran and live the Islam that Allah wants in the Quran, so that on Judgment Day, when the messenger picks up the Quran to accuse those who have abandoned the Quran abandoners and neglecters, we will not be amongst them. We will be standing somewhere else, and we will be with those, I told you so. And I look forward to that day where I'm going to say to this Sheikh and the thousands like him, I told you so. The messenger told you so. And before I close this, I will say this, that when Allah spoke about people being Quran neglectors, he spoke, the ayah is valid, i.e., every single time, every single day, when people rise in the believer world, i.e. in our Muslim world, with those who believe in the Quran, those who neglect the Quran are far more than those who follow it. And this is true every second of the day. Until my next meeting with the Sheikh, I've omitted so many points of discussions that I had with him and so many things, because otherwise it's going to take 3 hours or more. But I pray to Allah to guide me and him and all of us to the book of Allah, understand it, and apply Islam as Allah wants it. Until my next talk, please stay in the mercy of Allah. This is again your brother Abdus Salam Abu Hanifa. And until my next talk, stay in the mercy of Allah. Assalamu alaikum.